not quite as cold as it has been the last few days, but it's nice to see you here anyway, it's worth it for us. If you have your bulletins, there's just a few announcements. I guess on Wednesday night, the youth are going to be at the parsonage for a party, I guess, some kind of party. And so everybody, we don't have a lot of youth here today. The 21st, the youth group is hosted at the Woodrow family, and then February 3rd, the public annual meeting at the Bethany Free Church in Beverly Place. Does anybody else have anything more than that? Okay, well, we'll join me in prayer then, and we'll start our service. Dear Lord, we just to again humble ourselves before you. We thank you, Lord, for a place of worship and everyone that can get together this morning. We just do pray that we would have a blessing this morning with our service and the pastor, just be with him also. And we just ask that you would be with each and every one that's out and about in the cold weather and just give them safety in driving and going to and fro. And we just do be especially with each of us this morning again. We thank you for everything you've done for us. And I mean, praying that. Okay, if you'll turn to your hymn books, or I guess use the...
We'll do the call to worship.
Oh, yeah, we got to do the call to worship. Sorry. Got a rookie up here. Okay. Blessed are you, O Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness, power, glory, the victory, and the majesty, both in heaven and in earth.
Yours is the dominion, O Lord, and you exalt yourself as head over all.
O riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all.
In your hand is power and might, and it lies in your hand to make great and to strengthen everyone.
Now therefore, we come before you, our God, with thanksgiving to praise your glorious name.
Thank you. Now, if you would turn in your hymn books to 410, and we will sing 1, 2, 4, and 5, Standing on the Promises.
Thank you.
we're going to start with the 10,000 reasons, and I think we should start with these courses.
Thank you.
To the angel of the church in Sardis, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die. For I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me, dressed in white, for they are worthy. The one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches.
You can tell we're back in our series on the seven churches from Revelation. And is this working yet? Is it working yet? Test tape 1, 2, 3. This is the test of the emergency microphone system. If not, you can just turn this one on. Test 1, 2, 3. Psalms 1, 2, 3.
Check your mute.
Testing. 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
4, 5, 6.
Now you're there.
Pardon? We're good. Okay. So we are looking at the seven churches in Revelation that Jesus spoke to through the Apostle John. And we're going to look at the churches of the living dead, or the church of the living dead. It's part 7 in our series. This is the 5th church. And we want to look at Jesus' words and admonitions to them and to us. But before we do, let's pray. Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would open our heart and our minds, Lord, to your word. That by your Holy Spirit that you would show us, Lord, what you're saying to us, Lord, as individuals and as your church. In the name of Jesus, amen. You know, I hear people say all the time that they wish that our church or the church could be like the church in the first century, like the New Testament church. And then I read from Revelation 3 here, and I think you want to be careful maybe which church you want to be like from the early time, right? Because one of the truths is that the church, because it's filled with people who are in the process of sanctification and are being saved, is never a perfect place, and even back then it had all kinds of challenges. So before we look too much into the word here about this, I want us to consider what the city of Sardis was like, because it tells a little bit about maybe what the church was going through. Sardis is a city about 50 miles inland from the Aegean Sea. It's 30 miles southeast of Thyatira. It's located in what's now Turkey, and it was located up on a plateau, a very high plateau. It was considered at one point to be a place where it couldn't be impregnable. It couldn't be gotten at by the enemy, but that turned out to be false. It was at one time the capital of the ancient kingdom of Lydia, and this kingdom covered all of Asia Minor, and it dated as far back as the time of when the book of Judges was written. When the kingdom fell to the Persians, it became one of their most important cities. It remained the leading city of trade, commerce, and exchange when the Greeks ruled it. And later, when the Romans took over, it became the capital of the province of Lydia. And it was located at 5 different crossroads of trade. And because of that, it was a very wealthy city. It had a lot of money. It was considered to be a very important place. And it was acclaimed throughout the centuries as a town that was rich, powerful both politically and financially, and it also had spiritual significance as well, because they always had a big temple there. And the cities of the ancient world held the city in great respect, And the greatness of those grand and glorious days were never forgotten by the people who lived in Sardis. They were very proud of their heritage. But when we start looking at this city in the New Testament, we can just see a glimpse of that, of its former greatness. As the civilization of the times developed, it was no longer big enough to hold the new buildings they needed for how complex a government had grown. And because it was located up on a plateau, it basically just became not a good place for that. And so the city government moved from there to the town of Pergamum. So it lost its political power. After it was defeated umpteen years earlier, it no longer became this great fortress. So it lost a lot of its military importance. It was once, you know, the capital of a big war machine, and it was greatly feared and respected, but now it had become just another city. Its buildings remained, it looked important, but it was just really a shadow of its former self. Its main claim in the time when this scripture was written was that it had a lot of money, and it had a lot of luxury that money bought. And it was also a very spiritual place, and it was known for its worship of the goddess Cybele. Maybe we could pronounce it Cybele. I'd like to pronounce it Cybele. C-Y-E-B-E-L. Sometimes with two L's and an E, but Cybele is how I think it's pronounced. And it had a huge temple in Sardis, and how big the temple was often tells you how important it was to the cities. And this thing was gigantic. It was monumental. And this goddess was thought to be the great mother, or the mother of the gods. And her priestess led worship with all types of perverse and immoral ceremonies, complete with wild music, with drumming that would reverberate, with dancing, drunkenness, and sex of all types. Her most dedicated followers were males, who during one of their ecstatic rituals would castrate themselves or cut off their testicles. And after that, they would be given women's clothing, and they would assume female identities and could work in the temple. This city was caught up in degenerate immorality. And you can imagine, although it was no longer an important city holding political power, it still maintained spiritual significance, and it maintained the fact that it was important because it had lots of money, and the people remained very proud of it. Wealth still abounded in the city. They were proud of their past. But the people, for the most part, were caught up in degenerate, demonic worship, which, because of the wealth of their area, they had plenty of time to participate in. So to sum it up, the citizens of this city in the time in which the New Testament was written, they were no longer important players in the world of power. Their worship led them to become pleasure-loving, narcissistic, heathenistic, self-indulgent degenerates, who simply thought they were major players. Once a great power, this city was now a place of the past. Sardis had a name and a reputation, but for the most part, she was dead or dying. And it seems like this is the case for the church as well. It seems like it also had a reputation, as Jesus said, for being alive, but was dead. One of the first things I noticed when I studied this text was that, unlike the other churches where Jesus addresses, there's no commendation. There's no like, hey, this is what you're doing good. He goes right to the point. He says, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. And so getting off with telling them what they're doing well. And I thought it was interesting. He says, you have a reputation for being alive, but you're dead. Kevin, what do you think the chances are of getting a glass of water? And he says, you have a reputation for being alive. So in other words, you might think you're alive, and I think they did think they were alive. The other churches around you probably think you're doing great. This city might think you're doing good. But I know you. I know what's going on inside of you. I know my church, and you're dead. And when he says when you have a reputation for being alive, that reputation, I think, is because the church got off to a good start. When the grace of God first came to that area, people were rescued from sinless and fruitless lives. You can imagine if you lived in that city and you were participating in this disgusting, degenerate worship, right? All under the influence of these demon gods, and Jesus came and saved you. I mean, what a great thing. What a wonderful thing that the grace of God was at work in the middle of a city under the rule of demonic power. People were being made alive in Christ. They were fleeing their old lives. They were embracing the new life, and they were experiencing the power of God that comes from the transformation of the Holy Spirit. And I think that's where they received their reputation. I can imagine people from the other churches, you know, maybe at the latest conference. Wow, God is at work in Sardis. Did you hear that guy's testimony last week? Man, that was something else, you know. So much has changed for man. That church is really on fire. I imagine they had this great reputation. And you know, it's a funny thing how that reputation continued to go on even though it was no longer the reality. So they got off to a good start, but they weren't actually doing that well. And I also think they originally, he says, you have a reputation for being alive. So the church probably embraced that and said, you know, you guys have this great reputation that Jesus is working in your place. They also had a reputation, I'm positive, with the city, and it was a bad reputation. Right? It was a bad reputation from the city. You can imagine, right? Oh, those guys, the lost sinners of Sardis, don't like these Christians with their weird religion. They're so backwards, they're bigots, clinging to old-fashioned ideas that we're to live moral lives, that matter to be men, women, and women, that you're supposed to be married. What? What losers. They don't appreciate our spirituality. Right? That's how it works. And I'm sure they thought they ought to be outlawed, maybe arrested. Arrested for hate speech, no doubt. And I'll tell you something, as I was looking at this, I was thinking, a church that's alive doesn't have peace with the world because we're at war with the world. A church that's praised by the world, a church that's loved by the world, is actually a church that's in trouble. When we become so complacent, when we become so lukewarm, when we become so unengaged in the world that the world looks at us and sees us as no threat and no worry, we're actually a church in trouble. So Sardis has its own troubles that made it a dead church, and I think we want to be careful that we use this term carefully. I've heard it thrown about, and I'm guilty of it myself. I've probably told you in years gone by, I was quite sure that I knew which churches were which. I knew which were perfect churches, which was our churches. Those who weren't so perfect, and then those dead churches with dead words and dead people and dead songs. And one day I was praying because some fundamentalists had written letters to people in my church. We were leading people to the Lord. I was quite impressed with the grace of God at work in our midst. And some fundamentalists wrote us and said that we were all going to hell, that I was leading them to hell, and what a low life I was. And I was really hurt by that letter. And I was praying, and I said, God, you know, this brother I don't understand how he doesn't see your grace at work. People are being saved. People are repenting. People are coming alive to God. People who have been out of church for 25 years, sitting around doing nothing, are now engaged in your work. How can he not see your grace at work in this church? And I heard the Spirit of the Lord speak to me and say, the way you don't see the grace at work in my church. And I said, oh Lord, I see the grace of what, I mean, the fundamentalist, I'm not questioning that he's my brother in Christ. I think he's just like my strange cousin, but he's my family. And the Lord said, no, I don't mean that. I mean all those other churches that you say are dead. And see, that guy said that we're doing things by the power of demon spirits. And the Lord showed me that, yeah, I would talk about these other churches and I would say that they do things that they're filled with religious spirits. And I realized what I'd been doing is I was lumping everything up in one ball and was declaring everything dead because, well, one, is it seemed dead to me. But I'm not the one that stands. I'm not the one that stands with the seven stars in his hand. I'm not the one who gets to judge those things, right? So I'm looking at churches, right? I used to lump all... I won't even say it. is I'm ashamed. I love all these churches that once held their dead churches. So I say now, after the Lord has chastened me on it, be careful that we don't just throw that phrase around and call churches dead because we don't like their style. Many people use the term when they visit a church, they don't like the music. It's either too slow or too fast, too many hymns, the service is too short. I don't know that anybody has ever complained about it being too long. Right? It's dead because there's no programs. What they really mean is it's small or rural. Right? Small isn't dead, it's just small. No, you don't understand. They have no MOPs, no youth groups. You know what a MOP is? See, you must be one of those churches. You don't even know what a MOP is, right? Mothers of Preschoolers. And we meet together and we pray, I guess. Actually, I think you escape the preschoolers. Or it's dead because the I can't even say a sentence like that. It's an abomination. The pastor preaches too long. Never. The music's too long. It's too short. No one lifts up their hands. It must be dead during worship. Or worship. Everyone lifts up their hands. Well, style is not what Jesus is talking about when he's talking about the death that's entered into this church. Sardis has troubles that make it a dead church. Number one is it suffered from narcolepsy. You know what that is? That's where it's a disorder that causes a person to just fall asleep. Not just on Sunday morning either. They fall asleep, anybody might be driving, boom, they'll fall asleep. They just cannot stay awake. It's a sleeping disorder that causes them to be unable to stay awake. Jesus says in verse 2, wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die. So wake up, he tells his church, you're asleep at the wheel. I have saved you. I have called you out of that darkness. I haven't called you out of that darkness to put you on a shelf, but to be my witnesses, to be those who will demonstrate my love to a perishing world. And you're sleeping. Get up, get back to your beginnings. They also suffered from dropping the ball. I was trying to come, is there a basketball term for that? Stan? A guy who always drops the ball? We don't have a name for it. He's just a ball dropper. Okay, well, that's what these guys were. They kept dropping the ball. He says, I have not found your deeds complete in the sight of my God. This church, it started off good, and we don't really know how much time had gone by from the time the gospel had come to where Jesus is saying this exactly. But we know for sure they got off to a good start. They had a great reputation because the grace of God had been at work. Now, they're living on their reputation instead of their reality. They haven't continued on, and that's what this is saying. It's not just saying, okay, you guys started something you didn't finish. And he's saying, you're not continuing on in those things that you're supposed to be continuing on in. You got started well, or your church did, but it's no longer growing. You're no longer growing. Your deeds are not complete inside of my God. You're no longer accomplishing the work of Christ in your own life or in the church. They had dropped the ball. The only ball they were playing was hero ball. Everyone doing their own thing. Do you like that sports thing put in there? Huh? And then they also suffered from amnesia and Alzheimer's. Right? They had memory problems. They had heard and received the gospel and they had forgotten it. How does that happen? They had received, they've heard the gospel, they knew the gospel of Jesus Christ and they had forgotten it. Jesus says, remember. Remember, therefore, what you have received. Remember what you have heard. Obey it and repent. And they chameleoned. Now, one of the things that you can thank God for when you come to our church is that you can learn new words. Right? I'm not just a preacher. I'm also an instructor of new vocabulary words. Chameleoned. This is when a person, like the lizard, changes for its environment. So you're like the chameleon, and you are, it's past tense or it's process, right? You have chameleoned. It means you have become like the lizard, that when that lizard is on the wall and the wall is white, it turns white. When the wall is gray, it turns gray. When the wall, you got the idea, right? They had chameleoned. The Christians and the church had become like the culture they lived in. And instead of changing the culture, they'd been changed by the culture. They no longer stood against darkness. Rather, darkness filled the church. You know, the shame and the danger is it's a lot easier to happen, I think, than we realize it is. It's easy to become these chameleon Christians. Their city and their region was under this oppressive power of demons, and they exerted great influence on the unredeemed. The Word of God says that our battle is not with flesh and blood, but with powers and principalities. And sometimes we forget that. We think that our problem is with governments and political parties and with people, and we don't realize that there are spiritual powers, demonic forces that are at work on this planet, around us, especially in the lives of the unredeemed, and they exert great influence. And this worship of Cybele, with its perverted immoral orgies, all done in the name of spirituality, this form of worship was accepted, it was celebrated, and it was practiced by the community at large. It was practiced by the it was taught at the schools. It was practiced by the militia. It was practiced by the government officials, the neighbors, everyone except for those who were being redeemed and were being changed and sanctified by the blood of the Lamb of God. So to not agree with this type of spirituality was to put you at odds with almost everyone in your hometown. That's not a comfortable feeling. I read a study one time about people who go work in an environment where there's a lot of people who hold beliefs different than theirs. That the majority of people will change their beliefs and begin to think and act like the people they work with. And it's not because they've been convinced that those people are right, but because it's a lot less work, it's a lot less effort, and it's hard to be in an environment where you feel almost a sense of hostility because everybody believes different than you believe, and it's easier to chameleon. And at some point, this church gave in. You know, one of the things that's interesting too is, unlike the other churches, this church hasn't faced persecution. Jesus doesn't say a word about persecution like he has with the other churches. And I think the fact there's no persecution says something about the church. They're living in a city known for its immorality, and yet there's no conflict like these other churches faced. One writer said that called the church at Sardis the perfect model of inoffensive Christianity. He said the Jews and the Romans didn't bother the church because the church didn't bother them. It was left alone because it lacked the conviction to stir the waters and make any waves. Well, this church was no longer at war with the world. And maybe at first it was probably just silent out of fear of rejection. You know, sometimes it's easier just not to say anything than it is to create a problem, right? Sometimes it's easier just, I'm not going to say anything, just be quiet about it. And then sometimes there's even a consequence. If you're actually verbal and you actually say what you know to be right, or you know, say what is the truth from the Word of God, you can end up with a consequence to that. You can lose your job, you might not get a promotion. You can be sort of segregated and ostracized by the groups that you're with. But I think at some point they went from that to deciding that this practice of spirituality really wasn't that bad. And I was thinking that in order to get there, one of the greatest dangers is when a church is not busy about the Father's business. When we're not actively engaged in doing something, it's very easy to lose sight of a lot of things. You know, I was thinking about when the Word of God says, talking about King David, when he got caught up in the sin of adultery with Bathsheba. You remember the story, right? She's out on a rooftop bathing, and he's got his little binoculars out, I guess, or his big eyes are looking out the window, and he falls upon her. But you know the whole story, you know the story, right? He sees her, calls her, ends up sleeping with her, ends up killing her husband. A real ugly part of King David's life. But that story begins like this. It says, now, in the time when kings were out to war, David was at home looking out the window. And there's something about being at war, making sure that we have a mentality that we're engaged and we're active, I think that helps us not slide into this sleep. Because at some point, this church went from not just being silent, but maybe deciding it really wasn't that bad. I mean, is this that big of a deal? And then it went from that into accepting and welcoming into the church those who practiced this demonic worship. And maybe they welcomed them in thinking that they were being loving. Saying, you know what, we love sinners, so come on in. Amen. We need to love sinners. And our churches should be welcome and opening and accepting places, accepting of people, but not accepting of demonic worship, not accepting of behavior that's against the Word of God. And especially not by accepting sinners saying that we accept a lifestyle or we accept a worship of another God and then actually aid in their destruction. But at some point, that's what that church did. It began accepting to welcome into those churches, not saying that they needed to change, not saying they needed to repent, not saying there was transforming power available for them, not saying, listen, Jesus is the one and the only way. There is not two ways. You must surrender your old life and you can have a new life. But you don't get the new life if you hang on to your old life. That's not what was being done. They accepted and they brought them in. And then as time went on, many members began practicing the very thing that at one time they had escaped from. So it went a full cycle where the church had lost its witness. It went full circle where the church was no longer separate. The church was no longer on fire. The church was no longer a light in the darkness. The church was no longer a bell tolling for people to be saved, to watch out for the destruction that was out in the sea by the rocks. Instead, it had become just like the world. And we know that these members had begun practicing it because Jesus says that there's only a few left that had not soiled themselves in the sin of the day. And I was thinking the most frightening part of this whole passage of Scripture to me is that the church was dead, it was asleep, and it possibly didn't even know it. It didn't even know it. It was actually thought everything was good. And I was thinking about how when Delilah, you remember her, Samson was the great warrior and the judge of the Old Testament, in the book of Judges, and he had great power, and somehow the power is related to the fact that he had taken the Nazarite vow and he had cut his hair. Delilah, who was a Philistine, is trying to find out what the secret to his power was. She finally, you know, he's sleeping with the enemy, she finally gets it from him, it's cutting his hair off. So she waits till he's sleeping, cuts his hair off, casts some of his hair off. And then she decides to put it to the test. She says, Samson, Samson, get up, the Philistines are here, they're attacking. And he jumps up, expecting the word of God, says that he will do like he's always done with this great power that comes from the Spirit of God. And the word of God says he jumps up, not knowing that the Lord had departed from him. And I think that's what this church was like. It didn't even know that it had the shape and the form of Christianity, and they really didn't realize it had absolutely no power at all. Jesus says, I know your deeds, you have a reputation of being alive, but you're dead, so wake up. Remember what you've received. Strengthen what remains. Obey it. Obey me. Obey my word. Obey my spirit. Repent. And implicit in this is that Jesus loves his people and he loves his church. And he's not willing for them to perish. He wants them to be restored. He wants them to repent so that he can forgive and to restore them. And he says, but if you don't, I will come to you, and I will come to you when you're least expecting it. And he's not talking about the second coming. I think he's talking about coming to them and judging their church. But he promises them, and he says, that those people who have remained faithful to me, they will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. And I will never blot out their name from the book of life. You know, in that day, in that time in Sardis, when you died, they took your name off the roll of the city. And Jesus says, you know, if you're in me, your name will never be removed from my roll. I will acknowledge you in that day, in that time, in that hour. Right now, maybe everybody is against you. Maybe everybody thinks you're crazy. Maybe everybody thinks that you're the problem. But the day and the time will come when all of humanity will stand in front of Jesus Christ and all the angels and all the host of heaven and God the Father himself. And it's at that time, I will say, you're mine, and you're mine, and you're mine, and you're mine. I will acknowledge you before my fathers and his angels. He says, let him who has an ear hear what the Spirit says to the church. So, we're at war with the world, and that's okay, it's normal. And I think this word reminds us it's not good enough to have a good start, but we want to make sure that we finish the race, we continue the race, and we finish it. And we don't want to rest on reputation or things that have gone on in our past, not even personally, or as a church, but we want to deal with reality. What is God doing in us today? Are we growing? Are we going today? So let's examine ourselves and make sure that we aren't getting sleepy. Satan's goal is to cause the church and God's people to be ineffective. He likes to infiltrate the church with false teachers who will seduce God's people into believing and practicing what the world believes and practices. Or he hopes to pressure us with the war of the world, hoping that he's going to wear us out and that we'll simply surrender. We must therefore always allow the Word of God, amen, to be the guide as to what's right and what's wrong in our lives, what's godly, what's ungodly. We must trust the Spirit of God to keep it working us. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, that you love your church so much and love your people so much that you, like a father, you're willing to discipline and correct, and you're willing to show us, Lord, when we aren't doing something right. And we thank you, Lord, for this word that you put in the book of Revelations about this church at Sardis, Lord. This church that we don't ever want to be, Lord. And we don't want to be the Christians of that church, Lord. We want to be on fire. We want to be awake. We want to be about your business, Lord. We want to be filled, Lord, with your love and your Spirit. Lord, we ask in the name of Jesus that you'd protect us, Lord, that you'd help us, Lord, that we wouldn't grow weary and that we wouldn't grow sleepy. Lord, that we'd be busy about your business in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen.
Closing turn, page 60, or God, or bless God.
Share with those who have wandered off the path. Encourage those who are discouraged. Encourage those who are weak or feeling like they're forgotten. Be about the Father's business. Let your hands be his hands and your lips his lips. And as you go, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord take great care of you. And may the Lord give you and those you love great peace in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen.